it possible for us to have the Psalm 24? Bless the Lord. Welcome everyone this morning as we get settled this morning. Thank you. Hallelujah. We bless your name, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Could we stand at this time, everyone? If you can, please stand. Thank you. If you can find Psalms 24, can we have it on the overhead, please? Welcome, welcome, welcome. As we enter into the sanctuary with a heart of praise this morning. Hallelujah. We're settling ourselves this morning. Hallelujah. Praise God. Can we just give God the highest praise this morning? Hallelujah. Hallelujah to Jesus. Come on. Hallelujah this morning. You are worthy. 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 Hallelujah. Oh, we exalt you, Jesus. We exalt you. We exalt you this morning. Hallelujah. Praise God this morning. Can we, everyone, just read that first verse together? Can we read it together? The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. It means each and every one of us this morning belongs to God. The world belongs to him. Everything belongs to God. And this morning we want to worship him. Sing to the Lord a new song. For he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp. With the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horns, shout for joy before the Lord, the King, our King. And that's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to shout to the Lord in singing. We're going to shout with our hearts. And I'm inviting everyone at this time, children, adults, everyone, open up your mouth this morning and let us welcome his presence. He is here. We're going to celebrate him. We're going to honor him. And we pray above all things that he will receive our offering of sacrifice this morning. Come on, everyone. Father, we thank you. Father, we honor you. Father, we lift up your name, the name which is above every other name. We thank you, Jehovah. We thank you, God, this morning for allowing us this privilege and this honor that we can come one more time and enter into this your presence to love you. And so we worship you. We worship you. We honor you. We magnify you. We love you. We adore you. Your name is to be praised. Your name is to be magnified. God, many of our hearts this morning, some of our hearts are broken. Some of our hearts are bruised. Some of our minds are perplexed this morning. Some of us, oh God, just want to give up and walk away. But because we know the Creator lives and he is God, gives us strength for one more day. And so we thank you today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We honor you. We magnify you. We love you, Lord. Come on, somebody. Help me worship him this morning. Help me worship the King of Kings and the Lord of God. He is worthy this morning. And Brother Roy comes forward in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Your presence is heaven this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures. Son and Holy Ghost. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Praise God from whom?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Sing it one more time, praise God.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Praise Father, Son.
Praise Father, Son, and praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
One more time. Praise Father.
Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Father,
we bless your name and we glorify you. We thank you, O God, for another day, O God. The land of the living, O Father. We thank you, O God, for strength. We thank you for life. We thank you, Jesus, that we are here alive and well this morning, O God. Hallelujah, Jesus. We worship your name and we glorify you, O God, Jesus. For we are no longer slave to sin. We are no longer a slave to sin. We don't have no fear. Hallelujah, Jesus. You died for us on the cross. You already give your life for our sin. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, we bless your name.
You unravel me with a melody, you surround me with a song of deliverance. from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am of God, child of God.
If in the way, just sing it with me. You unravel me,
you unravel me with a melody, with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance,
of deliverance
from my enemies,
from my enemies,
till all my fears are gone,
till all my fears are gone.
Sing, you unravel me,
you unravel me
with a melody,
with a melody.
You surround me,
you surround me with
a song of deliverance,
of deliverance
from my enemy, till all my fears are gone.
Say,
I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am child of God. I'm no longer a slave to sin. For I am a child of God.
I'm no longer a slave.
I'm no longer a slave to sin. For I am child of God. I'm no longer a slave to sin, for I am a child of God.
From my mother's womb,
from my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Your love has called my name.
I've been born again,
I've been born again to your family. Your blood flows through my veins.
From my mother's womb,
from my mother's womb,
you have chosen me,
you have chosen me.
Your love,
your love has called my name.
I've been born again,
I've been born again
into your family,
into your family.
Your blood flows through my veins.
I'm no longer a slave to sin,
for I am a child of God.
For I am a child of God.
See,
I'm no longer a slave to sin.
For I am a child of God.
From my mother's womb,
from my mother's womb, you have chosen me,
you have chosen me.
Your love has called,
your love has called my name.
Say, I've been born again,
I've been born again
into your family,
into your family.
Your blood flows through my veins.
I'm no longer a slave to sin.
For I am a child.
Sing it out to him.
Hallelujah. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, Jesus, Father.
God is good.
I don't want you to just sing the song. I want you to believe what you're singing. I am a child of God. I want you to believe what you sing. Just don't sing the song because it's a song. You split the sea so I can walk right through it. My fears are drawn in perfect love. You rescue me so I can stand and sing. You rescue me so I can stand and sing. I am a child of God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child. Somebody need to sing that this morning. I'm no longer a
slave to fear.
For I am a child of God.
For I am a child.
I'm no longer a slave to fear.
I'm no longer a slave to fear.
For I am a child.
For I am.
Of God. You see that word fear? That word fear is what holding a lot of us back.
Yes, fear. Yes.
We could have accomplished so much stuff in our life, but that word fear is what holding us back. We fear about what people will say. We fear about what will happen. As long as we get over that fear, we can accomplish anything. We can do anything. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, we bless your name. We glorify your name, oh God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus, Father. Father, we bless your name and we glorify you, oh God. For you're worthy to be praised and you're worthy to be lifted up, oh God. Jesus came and loved me, took my sins to Calvary. He has made a way for me. Now my eyes are open since I've come to know him. His great love has set me free. Jesus came to love me, took my sins to Calvary. He has made a way for me. Now my eyes are open since I've come to know him. His great love has set me free. At the cross, my Savior paid. All my sins were washed away just for me. Amazing grace. At the cross, sing at the cross. My Savior died. He shed his blood, was crucified just for me. He gave his life at the cross. Jesus came and loved me, took my sins to Calvary. He has made a way for me. Now my eyes are open since I've come to know him. His great love has set me free. crucified.
Was crucified at the cross.
Just for me.
Just for me.
He gave his life.
He gave his life.
At the cross. Amazing grace,
amazing grace at the cross.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Just for me, he gave his life
at the cross.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Just for me, what
Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, we bless your name, O God, and we glorify your name, O God. For there is no one else like you, Lord Jesus. We worship and adore you, O God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, we bless your name, O God. For you are worthy to be praised, you are worthy to be lifted up, O God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Give the Lord some praise this morning. For he is worthy to be praised. He is worthy to be lifted up. Hallelujah, Jesus. There is no one else like you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, we honor you, we glorify you, O God. Just for me, amazing grace at the cross. Just for me, he bled and died at the cross. Just for me,
just for me,
he was crucified,
was crucified
at the cross,
at the cross.
Let us worship God this morning. He is so worthy. His presence is here. I can feel him so much. His presence is a cloud right now. His presence is in this place. The Sarah said, reach out and touch the Lord as he passes by this morning. We're going to give the Holy Spirit the time he needs to do what he has to do. And God, this morning, do what you need to do. Pass through, sweep through. Have your way this morning.
Hallelujah.
Jesus came and loved me.
Hallelujah.
We worship you this morning. Do what you have to do. Do what you must do. Do what you must do this morning, Holy Spirit, this morning.
Death was paid. All my sins.
Say this morning that sometimes we come into church and we don't have the opportunity to greet each other and to say hi to each other. And sometimes you want to go to the back to say hi to somebody, but by the time you leave, by the time you're ready to do it, they're gone. So at this time, we're going to do a greeting. We're going to sing a very old song. It says, "Walk and talk in the New Jerusalem way." You're going to encourage somebody this morning, and those that are in the front, the only person that's not allowed to move is Sister Atkins. Everybody else, okay? We're going to sing the song, "Walk and Talk in a New Jerusalem Way." We're going to press along, and we're going to greet each other. So come on, everyone. Let us stand. Let us say hi. Say good morning to each other. Let's give God glory, honor, and praise this morning. walk and talk in the new Jerusalem way. Press along, press along. Thank you, praise team. Thank you. God bless you. God bless you. I just want to make some announcements this morning as we continue with our service. Hallelujah. Bless God. Come on, put your hands together for God one more time. Isn't God sweet? Yes. Nothing is sweet, sir. Sweeter than the honeycomb is he. All right? So we worship God. So our announcements this morning is our quarterly business conference will be held immediately after worship service today. All members are encouraged to attend our convention. Church of God of Prophecy Eastern Canada will be held here from Friday, August the 4th to the 6th. So nobody has any excuse why they cannot be at convention. You can get there by bus, you can get there by car, you can get there by metro. So please, you'll be hearing more about it. So we need to be there. This is our church. All right, so our Men Cave Fellowship will be launched on March 25th at 719 Rue Radisson. So after service, all the men, just come on up here. Brother Marshall will see you and to speak to you and give you some more information. That sounds wonderful. So Monday morning prayer in the sanctuary has been resumed. So bless God. Time 10:30. Ladies who are traveling with the bus to Niagara Falls, please know that your final payment must be made today. Bless the Lord. Bless God. God is good. Welcome again one more time, everyone in the house of the Lord. Thank you. Thank you for being here. It is so wonderful for us to fellowship together. Last night, I attended a ladies' conference. Our speaker was no other than Sister Yvette Barkley. Put your hands together for her. She did an amazing job. It was at the Ebenezer Church, and God is good. He's using our people. And let me tell you, if God is using you, don't be shy. We need to know. We need to encourage you. We need to, you know, come on. We keep our wonderful news to ourselves and give us the bad news. We want the good news too, right? We want the good news. We want the good news. And we have a lot of good news coming up. So God is to be glorified. So at this moment in time, I myself, Jacqueline Denise Saunders Orozco, is, you see why I use my full name? It's for a reason. I am the mission booster. Now, my motto is that mission is so important. We see what's going on in the world. Syria has war, then an earthquake. Turkey, earthquake. Sudan, war. There are people being maltreated. All of these things are happening. And if all you can give is $5, do you know how far $5 in some countries are? When we went to Sierra Leone, 1,000 US gave us what? $10 million or $1 million naira? So I'm telling you, some of these currencies don't mean anything. $5 can buy medicine, can buy somebody a bicycle, all of these things. So we're going to continue to dig deep in our pocket. There's going to be a plate here, and we're going to continue to give to the Lord. God is good. Mission, we need to be mission-minded. We have missions in Montreal. We have missions in Pinco. We have missions all over. And our youths last year collected for the homeless youth, which I think was such an amazing job. That is mission. Let us continue to do all of these things for God. So at this time, as we continue in this very important part of our service, it says, now remember this, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And he who sows generously will also reap generously. Let each one give just as he has decided in his heart. Please do not be under pressure, for God loves a cheerful giver. So I'm going to ask the ushers at this time. The gold plate is for mission, and then we have an offering. If not, you can put it in your tithes envelope. Also in the back, we have our bank machine. So if you want to give your tithes and offering that way, please do. God bless you as we continue in our worship session.
Can everyone please stand with us, please?
We will.
Offering this morning. We thank you for the people that gave it. Some gave willingly, some gave unwillingly, but it's still going into your store basket. And it will be used for your glory and for your honor. Continue to bless this local church as we try to strive towards what you want us to be. Continue to be with us in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Bless God. Bless the Lord, everyone, this morning. God is good. Oh, my goodness gracious, God is merciful. We sang a song last week. It says, God is the joy and the strength of our life. He removes all pain. I wonder if everyone had really thought about those words.
Yes.
It is such an amazing song. And our pastor is going to come this morning. We want to sing that song this morning. I know a lot of us know that song. We know it by heart. It says, God is the joy.
God is the joy and the strength of my life. He removes all pain, misery, and strife. He promised to keep me, never to leave me. He'll never, never fall short of his word. I'm gonna bless and praise him in the narrow way. And keep my life clean every day. I wanna go with him when he comes back. I've gone too far.
Let's sing it again.
God is the joy and the strength of my life. He removes all pain, misery.
Come on, Pastor, that's for you too.
He promised to leave.
Hallelujah.
Me, never to give. Never fall short of his word. I'm gonna bless and praise him in this narrow way and keep my life clean every day. I wanna go with
him. Come on, hallelujah.
When he comes back. I've gone too far and I'll never turn back. God is my all.
God is. And I think that we could just rest right there and say, God is. And then you could just fill in the blank spaces. We could just rest right there and just say, God is. And then you can just begin to name. You can just begin to fill in the blank spaces of who God is to you. The songwriter said, God is the joy and the strength of my life. Another songwriter said, God is my joy. God is my peace. God is my great strong tower. Who is God to you today? You know what God has done for you. And if you are sitting or standing in this congregation and you are conscious of what God is to you, come on, lift up your voices like a trumpet and shout a praise to Almighty God, because God is good. Hallelujah. God is great. God is powerful. God is all. God is my all in all. He removes all pain and misery. And you know, the great thing about this God is what the writer goes on to say. He promised to keep me, never to leave me. And that's the assurance that we have today, that the God that we serve is a God that is constant. He's always there. Even when you don't feel like he's there, he's always there. Hallelujah. God is. God is. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Speak your word today, Lord, to us in the quietness of our hearts. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight. O God, who has strengthened our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of God. I want to greet all the ministers and deacons. I want to greet Bishop Lee that is in the house today. Amen. I'm going to ask you, please do not leave at the end of the sermon. Bishop Lee is with us. And we want to bless him another time. Amen. So please do not leave immediately after. Greetings to all my family. Greetings to those who are joining us via our YouTube channel and also our Facebook page. It's great to be here this morning. There's any visitors, we want to greet you as well. Today, as we continue to reflect on the journey of Jesus to the cross, we want to be looking at the topic, going to Samaria. And I would like to read for us St. John chapter 4, verse 1 through 9. But I will also want to encourage you to read through from verse 1 through 42. You'll get the full story, which I know that most of you already know. But verse 1 through 9 says, "When therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again into Galilee. And he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well. And it was about the sixth hour. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water, Jesus saith unto her, Give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it that thou, being a Jew, ask drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. My friends, there are so much things that we could pull out of this chapter, chapter 4 of St. John. And I think that if it was okay for us to go through the entire chapter, we could be here talking, exegeting, preaching, encouraging from today into tonight, into tomorrow, and on and on and on. But permit me just to speak on these few verses that I've read from verse 1 through 8 or 9. And in this passage, we will see a nameless woman that can be considered as spiritually dead. She is desperately in need of the Savior. Not a Savior, but the Savior. Because I think that she may have had some Saviors, but she is in need of the Savior. This is a very familiar story that maybe majority of you would have heard at some point. And I believe that many people are in a similar position as this woman, searching for the right answers, but constantly looking in the wrong places. In verse 1, we see that nothing is hidden from Jesus. He is aware of all things. The scripture says he knew. Look at verse 1 again. He knew that the Pharisees had heard. What did they hear? They knew that John the Baptist was doing great things. John the Baptist was preaching the message of repentance. He was baptizing people. But Jesus knew that the Pharisees had heard that he was baptizing a lot more people than John. Even though Jesus himself was not the one going into the water and doing the actual thing. The Bible said his disciples. And you may ask, how did Jesus know? The scripture says he knew. Amen? He knew. So how did Jesus know? Now, it is not stated in this passage how Jesus knew that the Pharisees heard, but I want to believe that no one pinched him and told him anything. I want to believe that there was no leaked voice message. But he knew because he is the omniscient God. He is the omniscient one who knows all things. Things that are not verbalized are known by Jesus. If you remember the man that was paralyzed and was brought to Jesus by his four friends who let him down through a roof in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw him and also the faith expressed by his friends, Jesus said, Son, thy sins are forgiven. Now among the group of people present that day were some Pharisees, and the Bible said that these Pharisees had said within themselves, Who but God can forgive sins? Notice what is said here, church. They were not having an open discussion. They were not speaking audibly for anyone to hear. It was a thought. It was a thought.
had that was not verbally expressed. But the Bible said, Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said to them, why do you think evil in your heart or in your thoughts? And so, if you should ask me how Jesus knew that the Pharisees heard that he was baptizing more than John, I would suggest it is the same principle, because he knows everything. Jesus, who is God, because he said to Philip, when you see me, you see the Father. So Jesus, who is God, does not operate like man. His thoughts and ways surpass that of man. They are way higher. He knows what he is doing at all times. God knows all things, the past, the present, and future, and he knows them all at the same time. He not only knows what was and what is, he also knows what will be. More than that, church, he knows everything that could be but is not. God knows every thought of ours. God knows us the way we truly are. Yes, not just the way we seem to be. God knows us the way we truly are, because nothing is hidden from God. The scriptures illustrate that to us repeatedly. God knows us inside out. He has access to every thought, every action, and every mistake in our lives. God sees everything there is to know about us, even what we are thinking, and also our motives. God knows everything. God knows our habits. He knows our strength. He knows our weaknesses. He knows our very words before they roll off our tongue. He knows all our business. Everything he knows, because he's omniscient. In the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 10, verse 30, Jesus said, the very hair of your head are numbered. That is amazing, church. God is all-knowing. He is aware of everything about us. He knows what goes on in private as well as in public. He knows more about us than we want him to know. Truth be told, sisters and brothers, we simply cannot hide anything from him. There is nothing that stops his visions. Night won't help, and hiding won't help. We cannot escape. Almighty God, he knows. So the Bible said, when Jesus knew that the Pharisees heard that he was making and baptizing more disciples than John, verse 3 said, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee. Now, what is interesting about this statement is there are several routes that one could take if you are leaving Judea to go to Galilee. He could have taken two other routes that were a bit longer, and like other Jews did, had to cross over the Jordan River to get down into Galilee. The third route, which is going through Samaria, historically, friends, the Jews avoided completely because there was a fierce and long-standing hatred between the Jews and the Samaritans. What was the cause of this hatred? According to some historical data, some Jews intermarried to some Assyrians, And when they reproduce children, they were called the Samaritans. In fact, the devout Jews despised them so much that they referred to them as half-breed. The tension between these two groups of people was so strong that the Jews prevented the Samaritans from entering the temple to offer sacrifice to Almighty God. They had to build their own temple. They had their own copy of the Torah and their own religious system. There was this deep-rooted racial discrimination toward the Samaritans. But the Bible said Jesus, even though he was a Jew, needed to go through Samaria. Jesus needed to go through Samaria. Was not to have a confrontation with any Samaritans over any religious differences or over any political persuasion or political agenda. Jesus knew that there is this woman, my God, this nameless woman that is in need of the Savior, that is in need of meeting the Savior. So instead of following the custom of the other Jews by avoiding going through Samaria, Jesus insisted on taking this route because he was on a divine mission. Come on, tell somebody divine mission. Jesus was on a divine mission. As I was writing this sermon, I thought about what was the response of the disciples when Jesus told them that, hey guys, I'm not going up north, then cross the Jordan River to get into Galilee. I'm going through Samaria. These disciples never knew the purpose of Jesus going through this city. Can you imagine if they had known that Jesus was on a specific mission to deliver this person who has been manipulated by this evil spirit for years, and by extension a whole city who afterwards believed in Jesus, not because of what the woman said, but because they have heard for themselves. If they had known of all this, they would not have been so reluctant in going through this city. And I think this has a lot to say to us as well. As a church, as people who are beneficiaries of God's grace, if we only know the great potential, if we have to share the gospel with so many people who pass through our building week after week, the number of people who walk past our church building daily to go through the measure station, people who are broken and in need of a word of comfort, if we only know how many people are struggling with different issues right in our communities, you would change your attitude of behaving as the holier than thou. And rather ask yourself, who can I talk with? Who can I pray with? How can I minister to such an individual? If we only know. If we only could change our attitude and build relationship with people so people can begin to trust us instead of us judging them. If we only know the potential that we have to share the good news of Jesus Christ to the hurting. That's what Jesus did. Jesus had to go through Samaria, even though his disciples were having second thoughts. I'm wondering if there is a Samaria right in your community. I'm wondering if there's a Samaria right in the apartment where you live. I'm wondering if there's a Samaria right in the congregation. That the Spirit of God is nudging you to change your attitude, change your mindset, and go. Maybe you are scared like the disciples, wondering what kind of response or reaction you may get. But can I tell you, my sisters and brothers, when you are in the presence of Jesus Christ, when you are guided and empowered by the Spirit of Almighty God, there is no need to be afraid. Just the presence of Jesus makes a difference. And that is why David said in Psalm 23, even though I walked through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence. So if Jesus is sending you, if he has anointed you, you need not to be afraid. Verse 5 says, then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now it is important to note that this parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph is referring to the blessing of Joseph that is mentioned in Genesis chapter 48, verse 22. It says, and I give to thee one portion above thy brethren, which I take out of the hand of the Amorite, with my sword and with my bow. In that land there is a portion where Abraham had raised his first altar and received the first promise that his seed should possess that land. That portion had been Jacob's first halting place on his return from Padan Aram. My God, and he too, Jacob as well as Abraham, he erected an altar there. In a parcel of a field where his tent rested, which he bought and made it sacred to El Elohi, the God of Israel. Amen, church. That portion of land, Jacob built the altar. And he told Joseph that, listen, I'm going to give it to you. Now, there have been debates as to whether Shechem and Sychar are different places or it's the same. Some have argued that Shechem is Sychar, while others believe that they are not the same but are in close proximity. But what is important, church, to note based on scripture is that Sychar is located near the parcel of ground that Jacob gave his son Joseph. And what is rather interesting about Sychar is that it means deeply drunk. Sychar means drunken one. Sychar means madness. Psyche means falsehood. It carries the idea of deception and disappointment. Psyche refers or signifies to a confused state of mind or a mixed state of consciousness. But when you dig deeper, a little deeper, you will see that in biblical names, the meaning of the name psyche is end. E-N-D. And we are going to see, my friends, that Jesus is on this divine assignment to this place to bring an end to all this deception. Jesus is on this divine assignment to bring an end to the confusion and drunkenness that has plagued the city for a long time. Yes, there has been a cloud of darkness that blanketed the city of Samaria because of the sinful practices. This is the same city in Acts chapter 8 where Simon the sorcerer used witchcraft to bewitch the people. But guess who is coming to town? Guess who is coming to town? None other but the Messiah. None other but Jehovah. None other but Emmanuel. None other but the Redeemer. Guess who is coming to town? The Holy One of Israel. The Wonderful Counselor. The Mighty God. The Everlasting Father. And the Prince of Peace. He comes to town and introduces a new way of life. Jesus comes to town and he carries with him the spirit of liberation. He comes with that spirit of liberation to set people free. He never forgets what his mission statement is. According to Luke chapter 4, my God, Jesus never forget his manifesto. The spirit of the Lord is upon me. That is the Messiah, because he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. He has sent me to announce release, pardon and forgiveness to the captives, and recovery of the sight to the blind. Oh, he came to town to set free those who are oppressed, those who are downtrodden, those who are bruised, those who are crushed by tragedy, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord, the day of salvation, and the favor of God abound greatly. Jesus comes to town to set people free. And that is what he wants us to do, my friends. That is what he wants to do today to those of you who are oppressed with sin. Oh, the message is there is mercy. There is mercy. There is mercy with him now. Come now and he will surely give you rest by trusting in his word. If you are oppressed by sin, Jesus invites you to come. To come. Listen to verse 6. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well. And it was about the sixth hour. Now, last week I shared with you that Jesus restricted himself to a human body with all of its limitations. He had a body like ours, except it was without sin. He voluntarily limited himself to being a human being. So he could only be at one place at a time. As human, he needed to eat. As human, he needed to sleep. As human, he needed to rest. And here we are seeing one of those instances where Jesus needs to rest. The Bible said, being wearied with his journey, he sat on the well. Now allow me to share some important information to understand the text. Now remember when Joseph's brother sold him a slave in Egypt? I won't go through all the details, but he became the governor. He became the prime minister. There was a severe famine in Canaan, and Joseph saved his family from death and brought his father Jacob to live with him in Egypt. Jacob, that is Joseph's father, on his deathbed bequeathed this well to Joseph. After Joseph had died in Egypt, his body was transported back to where? To Samaria, and buried close to the well. This same well. The Samaritan claims Jacob as their father, and they trace their ancestors to Ephraim and to Manasseh, the sons of Joseph. Jesus, my sisters and brothers, recognized Jacob as one of his forefathers in the flesh, and he also understood that his own mission was to fulfill the covenant promises which God had made with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. Jesus now comes to Jacob's well, not simply to rest, but to bring revelation of the good news of salvation to the people of Samaria. Jesus was on a rescue mission. Yes, he was on a rescue mission to set people free from sin, from the powers of Satan and death, and bring them God's kingdom of righteousness, of peace, and of joy. That mission, that mandate, my friends, has not changed. It has not changed. It remains the same today. The church has been given a mandate to first and foremost exalt the name of Jesus Christ. The church has given the mandate to lift up the name of Jesus, because the Bible said if he be lifted up from this earth, he will draw all men unto him. Secondly, the church has given a mandate to edify. It is for the edification of the saints. We are encouraged and to build up each other. Yes, in words, in deeds, in exhortation, we are encouraged to build each other up. And thirdly, church, the church is given the mandate to evangelize, the evangelization of the world. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. That's our mandate. Firstly, lift up the name of Jesus. Glorify him. Honor him. Because when we do that, he will draw. The Spirit of God will draw all people unto him. Secondly, we must edify each other. Encourage each other. Help each other on the journey. Thirdly, we must evangelize the world. Go when you are empowered. Jesus said, when you have found me, go tell others. Verses 6 and 7 says, there cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy meat. Notice what happened here. Jesus sent his disciples away to buy food in the nearby town of Sychar. And he remained alone at the well. He was left alone. It reminds me of Jacob when he sent his family across the stream with all his possessions. and he was left alone. Being left alone, he had a divine encounter that changed his life completely. Jacob, the supplanter, became Israel. Jacob, the trickster, became a man of God. Jacob's life was changed completely because he was left alone and he had that divine encounter with Almighty God. Church, can you see the connection here? Jesus was left alone. My God. And he was there alone. But I want for us to think of something here. Jesus was left alone. And this woman was coming alone. Was a setup by divine order to change her life completely. My God, look at what happened. Regardless of how we view her, oh, she was doing her duty. She was dutiful. The role of a woman was primarily one of a domestic servant in the home. And during that time, the man was the dominant influence. And the woman did as she was directed. And her duties included preparing food for meals and storage. If the home did not have a cistern, she had to draw water from the village well and carry it home. And this is what she was doing. But she came at a time when no other women were drawing water. And there are many speculations as to why she came during the heat of the day. Some believe that she was despised by the other women. So she was not comfortable walking in groups. So she came by herself in the heat of the day when the rest of the women were at home enjoying the cool. She scheduled her day to avoid her deepest pains. She deliberately chose that time of the day because it indicates that she was a social outcast. Have you ever felt like that? It does not matter how much you try to fit in. It just never adds up. She was lost in a wilderness of her own brokenness. Maybe she had reached to that place of assumption that there was no fix. Nothing can be done to help her. She was far, too far gone. But friends, what is interesting about this story? When Jesus, the Savior of the world, when he saw her, my God, he asked for help from this broken soul. You don't see it. Jesus asked for help from this broken, wounded woman. He initiated a conversation by asking her for water. Give me to drink. This was a radical request in a church because it also required that he drink from her vessel, which in Jewish thinking was a very unholy and defiled vessel. But when Jesus approached her, he was willing to break that gender-based cultural norm and deeply racial prejudice that had established itself for years. But more than that, in Jesus' eyes, no one is too far gone. Hello, somebody? in Jesus' eyes, no one is too far gone. Amen. That his grace cannot reach. No one is too far gone. That his blood cannot cleanse. And throughout the Bible, we find stories of people who were considered the least, but they experienced God's grace. God cared for them. Just to name a few, God showed compassion to a guilty thief, who was being justly punished on the cross. God cared about Hagar, who was an outcast servant, who was about to die in the desert. I stop by to tell you this afternoon, church, that if you ever wonder if God cares about you, all you need to do is to look at these stories in the Word of Almighty God. If he loved them, you can know he loves you. If he cared about them, you can know that he cares about you. Does Jesus care when my heart is pained too deeply for mirth and song? When the burdens press and the cares distress and the way grows weary and long? Oh, yes, he cares. I know he cares. His heart is touched with my grief. When the days are weary, the long night dreary, I know my Savior cares. You know, the thing that I admire about Jesus is he is more concerned about people's eternal destiny. Unlike the rabbis of his time, who were consumed with social standards and what is acceptable, Jesus' mission was to seek and to save that which was lost. The scribes and the Pharisees were mad that Jesus associated himself with sinners, but the Bible said Jesus is a friend of sinners. That's the main reason he left his splendor in heaven and came to earth to redeem the lost. So by striking up a conversation with this woman, Jesus was moving slowly to deal with the spiritual. He started with the natural, with the intention, amen, of shifting to the spiritual. Church, God wants us to have that hunger to help those who are lost to come and know him as Lord. Not to be annoyed by the way they look. Not to be annoyed by the way they behave. Not to be annoyed by the way they carry themselves. No! But we need to ask God to help us to find ways to minister to those who are lost, those who are broken, those who are ostracized, those who are troubled. For this woman in our story, many of the devout Jews will look at her as a nobody. They would not even want to sit in her presence. But Jesus looked at her as someone that is valued and loved. Sometimes the situation that you find yourself in can cause you to believe that what is spoken about you. Maybe this woman had gotten to that place where she saw herself and begin to believe the label others placed on her. But by approaching her, Jesus demonstrates his care for all, regardless of their social standing. Jesus did not follow the prejudices of his day regarding gender and ethnicity. On the contrary, church, he lifted up and honored those, the culture marginalized. This is what we are called to do as a church.
There are many people in our communities who are wounded and needed to be dressed up and cared for. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul gave an excellent illustration to the believers in Corinth of what is the purpose of the church. And in summary, the church is God's hands, God's mouth, and feet in this world. We are the body of Christ. We are the body of Christ, church. We are to be doing the things that Jesus Christ would do if he were here physically on the earth. The church is to be the Christian, the Christ-like, and Christ-following. So we should be following the examples of Jesus Christ by looking at this story through the lens of Jesus Christ. Jesus initiated this conversation with this unnamed woman, which opened the door for the transformative power of the gospel of Jesus Christ to affect her life and by extension change an entire city. As I close today, the story of the woman at the well teaches us that God loves us in spite of our bankrupt life. Yeah. That's the love that God has for us. Despite our messiness, the story of this woman at the well teaches us today, church, that God's love is deep, it's strong, it is measureless. He comes to town to rescue you. God values us enough to actively seek us. That's what Jesus did. He could have gone the other route, but he decided, I need to go through Samaria. He actively seek us to welcome us to intimacy and to rejoice in our worship. He comes to us in our loneliness and pain and says, here is life. I offer you healing for your brokenness. I offer you glory for your shame. I offer you friendship or community for your loneliness. I offer you joy for your pain. I know that I did not go through all this story. But hear me, church. When you read through that story, the Bible said after Jesus changed this woman's life, she became this evangelist. And she left her water pot. No, there's something that we need to look at here. She left her water pot and she ran to the city. Can I tell you something, church? When she left her water pot there, it was not that she forget it, but she left her water pot there and she ran to the city because she knew that she was coming back. Lord God Almighty, if she had taken the water pot, she may never return, but she left her water pot because she knew that she was going to return to see the Messiah. And she started to evangelize. Come, see a man who told me all that I've ever done. I've heard about prophets. I've heard about many of them. But I know that this is the Messiah. He was a stranger. I did not say anything to him. But he begins to reveal to me the thing that I did in secret. This must be the Christ. She was changed. She was transformed. She received new life in Jesus Christ.
She had a new mission, a new mandate. Her mandate this time was not to go seek after other, but now to seek other for the kingdom. Praise team, come with me. Because when this woman experienced salvation in Jesus Christ, she was one of those who was fearful before. She didn't want to associate herself with people. She stood by herself. But when she was delivered, I believe she started to sing, I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. I'm no longer afraid or ashamed. My brokenness is now fixed. I am a child of God. When you are transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit, you can never be the same. And all the shame that you had, they are in the past. Because if any man is in Christ Jesus, he's a new creature. All things are passed away. And behold, all things have become new. She was new. And so she ran into the city. And she became an evangelist, shouting, come. Yes. You unraveled me.
Yes. You unraveled me.
Come on, church.
With a melody.
That's what happened to this woman.
You surround. A song of deliverance.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
From my enemies, till all my fears
are gone. From the top, one more time, you unraveled me.
You unraveled me with a melody.
Maybe you are here today.
You surround me.
And for one reason or another, you are like this woman who feels ashamed. You have been despised. You have been broken. You need to be redeemed. You need a touch. The altar is open. The second verse. You have chosen.
You have chosen me. Your love has
the altar is open
my name.
For anyone to come and experience
I've
peace.
Been born again.
Come experience joy.
Into your family.
Come experience God's grace. Come.
Your blood flows through my veins.
I'm no longer
a slave to fear.
I am.
For I am a child of God.
What is your struggle today?
I'm no longer a slave.
How
am
I laid at the feet of Jesus Christ?
For I am a child of God.
He wants to deliver you.
I'm no longer a slave to fear.
Come, God bless you.
For I am a child of God.
From my mother's womb.
From my mother's womb.
Can you imagine this woman running through that city with her head up high? She used to walk around with her head down. But now she's walking with her head high. Because she was born again.
Into your family.
She was now a part of the family of God.
Your blood flows through my veins.
I'm no longer
a slave to fear.
For I am
a child of God.
I'm no longer over your life today. I am a child of God.
For I am a child of God.
I'm no longer.
Come
on, declare it.
I am a child of God.
You split the sea.
You split the sea so I can walk right through it. My fears are drowned in perfect love.
You rescued. Jesus,
for
right
I
now,
am a child,
we pray that your power, your spirit, oh God, will begin to work, to manifest in the lives of these loved ones. Oh God, as they come to this altar today, God, you see and you know everything about them. You know about their uprising and about their downsetting. But right now, God, we are praying in the mighty name of Jesus, that by your power and by your spirit, you will bring liberation. You will bring deliverance. Oh God, whatever they are struggling with, whatever they are going through today, Lord God, you are coming to town to meet with them. I pray that, Lord God, as they make this step of faith and walk to this altar, that you, Lord God, will grant them a divine encounter. So that, Lord God, their lives will be transformed and renewed. Father, we are praying for you, Lord God, to work a miracle in their lives, that they will know that, yes, there is a God. There's God. There's a God who delivers. There's a God who set free. Oh, God, you have set the brokenhearted free, the captive free. You have healed the brokenhearted. And whatever, Lord God, their issues are, we know that you are greater. We know that you are stronger. We know that you are mighty. And so right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for a special touch. Touch your children. Anoint your people. Lift them up, Almighty God. Strengthen them by the power of the Holy Spirit, that they may live. Oh God, they may live. They may live, oh God. Father, I pray right now, that every fetter be broken right now. We break every fetter, every chain we break right now in the name of Jesus Christ. And I pray that the joy of the Lord will envelop their lives in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray for those who are struggling in their faith. May you strengthen them today so that they will continue to trust you in the process. In the name of Jesus. Oh, glory to God. We bless your name today, Father. We thank you and we glorify your name. Because you are God. 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 In Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, glory to God. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God.
To be Sister James.